The first thing you need to know about how money is created in the U.S. is that we have a fractional reserve banking system, meaning that banks are allowed to hold reserves equal to only a fraction of their total deposit liabilities. Look, think of a bank as being like a person, like you or me. How do we hold our money? We usually keep a little cash on hand and then keep the rest in the bank. Well, a bank does the same thing. The total bank reserves are partly cash on hand, or vault cash, and the rest sits in an account with the banker's bank, the Federal Reserve. This is the central bank for the United States. Now, banks are legally required to keep a certain amount of their total deposits, that is, the total of what their depositors have entrusted them with, on reserve. This can be either as vault cash or on deposit at the Fed, as long as it is accessible if the depositors ask for their money. The required reserve ratio, R, is the legally mandated percentage, so the total amount of required reserves is the required reserve ratio times the total amount that's been deposited with the bank, or R, times total deposits. The difference between the bank's total reserves and its required reserves are the excess reserves, the amount the bank is holding above and beyond the legal requirement. How then is money created? Banks create money by lending money, and the money that they can lend is the excess reserves. Okay, let me give you an example. Let's say that I move to this area bringing $500 with me, which I use to open an account with Wells Fargo. This means Wells Fargo now has an additional $500 in assets, my deposit, but also an additional $500 in liabilities. I could walk in at any time to get my money back. Now, supposing the required reserve ratio is 10%, Wells Fargo must hold on to $50 of my deposit, leaving $450 in excess reserves. Now let's say that Jim wants to buy a new car stereo, but he needs $450. Wells Fargo lends Jim the $450, that is, the $450 excess reserve asset is now replaced by the $450 loan that Jim will have to pay back, which he takes to the car stereo store. At the end of the day, the stereo retailer deposits the $450 with its bank, B of A. This means B of A has a new $450 deposit, $45 of which is required reserves, leaving $405 in excess reserves that it can lend out. How long will this process continue? Well, in theory, it could go on indefinitely, although the loans would get pretty small after a while. How much of an effect is there on the money supply? If I go back to the beginning, there was my initial $500 deposit, then a new $450 checkable deposit, then another $405, then $364.50, etc. The maximum change in checkable deposits, and therefore in the money supply, is 1 over R times the change in reserves. The ratio 1 over R is the simple deposit multiplier, or the money multiplier, in this case, 10. For this example, the maximum change is 10 times $500, or $5,000. Why is this the maximum change that we could see in the money supply? Because banks can lend up to 90% of their deposits, but they don't have to lend 90%. In times of higher risk, banks would most likely want to hold on to more than the legally required fraction of their deposits. Time to think. What happens if money is removed from the banking system? For example, what if I now go to Wells Fargo and try to withdraw the $500, assume for the moment that I'm their only depositor? How will they get my money back to me, and what happens as a result of the bank's actions? Next time, the Fed.